Hi, and welcome to this episode of Brainy Moms. I'm Dr. Amy Moore, here with my co-host, Teri Miller, coming to you today from a very sunny Colorado Springs, Colorado. Our guest today is Kolbe Youth Advocate, Gail Swift. Gail is fiercely committed to guiding students and families to take action in their natural abilities. What really excites Gail about her work is knowing that every single student is created with a pattern of taking action that doesn't change over time. That pattern predicts their path, which leads to their purpose. Her expertise has been honored by being in the first group of Kolbe Youth Advocates in the world. Appearances on podcasts, television segments, educational stages, and college open houses. Three unique things about Gail that might surprise you include: she loves watching her kids dance in the rain, taking hikes with her husband most Saturday mornings, and snuggling with her Rhodesian Ridgeback, Jax.
So sweet. Gail, we are so glad to have you here. Welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm super excited to be with you ladies today. It's great.
So before we launch into this really, really fascinating topic, I want to just hear your story, how you ended up where you are right now, becoming a Kolbe Youth Advocate.
And what that is.
What that is. Yes. All right. Really briefly, when I was five, I was diagnosed with Tourette's syndrome, a neurological disorder. And I was put on Halidol and dopamine when I was 5 years old. And I was very all over the place. So couldn't really focus, right? That the neurological disorder is a cognitive issue. And my mom obviously my parents put me on medication to try and calm me down. Well, it didn't work. It didn't work. And years later, I actually abused my privilege to take the medication at 15. I was still super hyper. So when my mom was at a National Network of Women in Sales meeting in Chicago, Illinois, she heard this woman talking about conation. She's like, what is that? And she learned through that meeting that conation is how someone is wired to take action. And people are wired to take action differently. And this opportunity to know this will provide focus and clarity. And my gosh, were my parents eager to hear that about me, because I was all over the place, right? So they're like, we're going to sign her up for this thing and she's going to get clarity and focus. So I did I think it was a graduation present. And I went and I heard for the first time in my life that I was born with a need to have a lot of things going on at one time. I was born to be last minute. I was born to need choices, to need freedom. And the reason that this was so evident, ladies, was my parents were so different. They were so different from me. And so it showed up, because no one had heard of this before. So it showed up as a negative and something to be controlled, something to be changed. And so in 1991 was the first time that I had actually heard about conation.
All right. And so then, how did you make the jump then to advocating for other children and families?
Right. Right. So even though I knew how I worked, it was hard for me to articulate, because conative stress is kind of a sneaky stress. It's not like when you meet someone and it's obvious that their personality is way different than yours, or IQ. It's not a cognitive thing. It's sneaky. So when I would have regular meetings over and over again, I would start to get stressed out, because I was like, why are we in these meetings? So I was in the meeting, and one day, and I just started to get up and walk out of the meeting, because no one told me I had to sit through a meeting. So when I was done with the information, I got up and I walked out. And I guess that wasn't normal. And one day my boss slammed his fist on the table. He's like, God bless it, Mahoney, sit your butt down. We are not done. And I was like, what is wrong? I got everything I needed. And I kept trying to live my way. I kept trying to do things my way. And it seemed like I was at a tug of war with the world, because the world was telling me I needed more information, or I needed a system to follow. I needed a format to follow. And I would push back on that and wonder what was wrong with me. But to answer your question directly, it wasn't until I had kids of my own and I started looking at them and realizing I was going to be with these little people for a long time. And I started telling them how to do things. And I got pushback. And I was like, okay, is this a defiant, disobedient kid, or does he have another way that he wants to get done what I'm asking him to do? So at 1 and 3 years old, I wanted to know how my kids worked so I could go with their grain instead of against their grain to get things done.
Nice.
That was the first time that I was really interested in seeing how other people solve problems, because it made my job as a mom easier. I had to wait until they were in fourth grade at the time. Now I work with three-year-olds. So it wasn't until legally 2016 when I was certified to do this that I obviously have been in it ever since.
Okay.
Fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Amy, I know you've got another question. Before we even get into that other question, I just want to just sort of clarify and explore for our listeners this entire topic in that terminology, because I went back to school as an adult, I mean, just what, a decade ago, to get my master's in psychology. And somehow I missed this concept. I am not familiar with this concept. And so in the last, preparing for this interview, I really dug into what is conation. I thought it was conation there for a bit. I heard one YouTube video describing it as conation. So conation, but it's like there's three different ways that the brain functions, or we think of as intelligence in our brain. And I had heard, obviously, of our cognitive intelligence, IQ. That's an easy one. We've all heard of emotional intelligence. Again, that's an easy one. It's how we relate to people. It's how our emotions guide how we think and what we do. But this one is different. Conation is your brain's ability to motivate and drive what you do and how you do what you do. And a word that made a lot of sense to me was volition.
Mm-hmm.
It's what motivates you, or how you are motivated, how you are driven to behave, to work, to act, to function.
Yes.
And so this is an entirely new concept to me. And I imagine for many listeners it is too, but you might be having that like, boom, light bulb moment of, oh my goodness, this is so important. Because this is an aspect that it colors everything about who I am and what I do and how I live and interact. So this is really huge. Listeners, I hope you're getting this, a new concept.
Okay, it is. Yeah, no, it's right. Volition, your will. Correct. Yeah. How you solve problems. It's the how. It's not the what or the why. It's the how. It's nice. Not that you can or can't do any. I mean, you can do it all. You can't do it all. It's your will and will not do naturally what you are naturally wired to do. So we can do all things, but what we will and won't do naturally, that's exactly what it is.
Okay.
Yeah. And I told Gail when we talked about having her as a guest that the only reason that I was even familiar with the concept is because I had a professor in my PhD program who specifically focused on conation. That was his research focus. Wow. And I hadn't heard anyone else talk about it since, right? And so I was super excited to be able to revisit that concept and to know that it serves as the foundation for this entire assessment process that can help us become better parents, right? When you said you were diagnosed with Tourette's, actually two of my children were also diagnosed with Tourette's.
Wow.
And, right. And so I understand the plight, the struggle of having to navigate those differences and having to meet them where they were. And if I had had this type of tool, you know, when they were diagnosed in kindergarten, wow, just think of how much better of a parent I might have been at the time, rather than trial and error and guinea pigging them and everything else, even as a shrink. So,
yeah.
All right. So, you say that, you help parents understand their children. So do they not already understand their children? What do you know that we don't know?
All right. I'm going to answer that twofold, Dr. Amy. I'm going to answer that twofold. So I think it's important. And Teri, you're skating around this. And I think it's important to know something that's kind of it's a missing piece. The third part of the mind has been around ever since Aristotle and Socrates and Plato. Like, it's always been there. It was called the moral compass. So it's always existed, right? It's been there. It's not like it's invented out of nothing. So it's been right there. It's called the moral compass a long time ago. And so what happened is Kathy Kolbe's dad developed the Wunderlich IQ test. So her dad developed a mental ability test. And before she could drive on the bus, when she was doing paperwork for her dad's cognitive assessment that is still used today, she said, and she's dyslexic. She's dyslexic. So she's like, "Dad, I'm noticing that there are other strengths besides grades and athleticism or outgoingness that people are good at. I'm noticing that they do things like when they're really putting forth effort, it's not just about the grades. There's more to it than that." And as a researcher, he said, "Figure it out. What are you observing? What are you looking at?" Right? So from the time before she could drive, she started noticing and writing down these patterns of taking action. That's how it all started. She didn't know at the time that she was making the development of an algorithm to measure people's instincts. So the conation, the third part of the mind, has always been there. She is the first person that has developed a way to test and measure instincts. And the only way they can be measured, because they're a subconscious force, the only way they can be measured is striving, trying, putting forth mental effort into doing something. So what do I know that you don't know? I know how my family works. I know that when someone is not into the details, if a child doesn't need the details, they're not going to read books for hours at a time unless it's for leisure. I know that when someone doesn't need to put their socks on that match or put things away in the appropriate folder, that they may have piles all over the room and they'll skip steps and shortcut. And I think that's fantastic. As a matter of fact, Dr. Amy, your son's a lot like that. He may have piles everywhere because he needs things out to see it. I can go on to the other four
and
modes.
How do you know that?
Right. I know because you showed me his results. But the point is that people aren't made with gaps. They're not made with holes to be changed or filled with something else. They're not less than. They're perfectly whole. So when you know their blueprint of how they're created, I don't try and make it different because I'd be hitting my head against a wall because it's not going to change. So getting your son, now that I know his MO, to pick up his room to someone else's specifications, in my opinion, is a waste of time. You're going to have your work cut out for you for the rest of your life.
I gave up.
There you go. There you go.
You have to live in your room. Live in your room. Just throw the food away.
Bingo. That's it. That's your choice, right? That's a choice. Yeah. If you would have known that when he was two, I mean, I don't know if you're like, now everything goes in this bin or this bin, but if he has one big tub or basket to put all his stuff, that's better for that student. So there's nothing wrong or nothing judgmental or a character issue because you're not going to make your bed every day or you're not going to have a clean room. That's not a judgment character issue. If you're born that way, it's not decency. It's just innate. Yeah, thank you for the rant.
This is so good. Amy, it reminds me of the conversation we had earlier today when you were talking about Evan making a switch. He's going to shift to a homeschooling, a more piles and free and open opportunity for him to finish his high school education. Mm-hmm. And he is so bright. He's so gifted. Amy's son that we're talking about. And Amy, we talked about this and I said, yes, go Yahoo, because I have so many regrets about my daughter, Autumn, who, it's interesting as you're talking about this, she's like that. Gail, she's the piles. Now she's created amazing coping mechanisms to have, everything has a spot even though it wouldn't be in its file, like I would tend to do, you know. But she had that propensity. And I just hear me, listeners, I failed her as a mom. And I mean, failed her. I wounded her because I said, you need to fit into my box. You need to fit into my filing cabinet and you need to do your schoolwork like this. I didn't just fail her. The school system failed her. We homeschooled for a while, but then when she did start getting into a regular school program, I venture to say that regular public school systems, charter schools, whatever, regular classroom settings do not work very well for kids that need to have piles. Because no, everything has to go tidy in your desk, in your file folders, in your notebooks. And if we can learn, if I could go back in time, Gail, take me back in time.
It hurts my heart. It hurts my heart to hear you
it
say
it. It hurts
that.
My heart now. But I want to be able to have her listen to this interview and say, Autumn, my honey, I know I failed you, but we can move forward. And I can learn with my other kids. And Amy, you're learning right now with Evan. You're making beautiful choices.
Well, and I think that it's very difficult to explain to someone with traditional thinking that it's okay to not try to force a square peg into a round hole. Mm-hmm. And so it's a matter of getting people to just shift their paradigm about what parenting looks like, about what education looks like, in order to best meet those individual characteristics and needs and innate instincts of our children. You know, if we want them to be happy and healthy, and if we want ourselves, you know, to have strong, positive relationships and not be in a constant battle with our children.
Yeah.
Right. So,
because Autumn had a really, really hard educational experience, really hard experience in high school, even though she's incredibly bright. She's just so talented and smart at so many things, such a go-getter, but she made her way eventually. And now she's 25, and she is doing incredibly, she's got these, you know, she's pursuing this advanced degree. She has made her way in her way. And it's beautiful.
It doesn't sound like you were too unsuccessful then.
Right.
Yeah.
I regret, you know.
Okay. So then how can you help parents? How can you help moms avoid this type of regret, Gail?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. If you picture a balloon that is really tight, full of confetti, the kind of confetti your girlfriend might send you in a card and it comes out all over the place on your birthday and it's irritating, like that confetti in the balloon. And every time that balloon is swaying to the ground slowly, and then right when it's about to hit the ground, the parent reaches out and protects the balloon from popping. However, it is only when you let the balloon pop and see what's inside that you see what they're made of. Parents have a hard time letting that balloon pop. And so what I would suggest is baby steps. Prove me wrong, because one of the major themes that my husband and I agreed upon when we first had kids is we wanted to raise contributors to the world, not takers, contributors. That was very important to us. You cannot have a passive contributor. You need an active contributor. It's an oxymoron if it's passive. So I'm like, I hear this about my second son, who's a pioneer, just like Dr. Amy's. And I was like, oh my goodness. Okay. So let me get this straight. This kid's wired to solve problems. I have his blueprint. I'm looking at the material that tells me what's going to stress him out. All right. So I have some choices to make as a mom. So what's important? I want a contributor. I want a child with integrity and respect for himself and others. I have to start deductive reasoning what's important. So he comes home from third grade as I'm giving him his freedom. And I notice he's not carrying any paperwork home anymore. And I said, hey, Tyler, I said, I noticed you're not carrying your homework home. You're not getting any more sheets, which I actually think are ridiculous. So I really don't care. And he's like, no, I've decided to take the ding. Oh, okay. Ding on what? Well, I asked my teacher how much or what it would cost if I didn't do my homework sheets. And she said, you're going to have a 10% ding on your grade. And he said, I'll take it. So now we have a third grader who has made a decision. He's dealing with the consequences. Can I just stop right there?
So good. Okay, so I love it.
I do too.
I so love good. It.
And it's never stopped. So I'm like, okay, now I've got something. Like now I have the blueprint. I'm seeing. So I'm I've always been an observer. Like you ladies are observers of your kids too. But I've always been like, okay, let's see how far we can go. So I started asking questions over suggestions. And I started saying, what next? What's your plan? And I would ask different questions depending on how my kids are working. Then I would see their eyes get bright again. And then I would see them start to dream. And then I'd follow the dream. I just follow the dream as a mom. And I recognize that when they do things their way with motivation, they will get them done. But the path to get there looks different. Yeah. And who cares how they get there, as long as they get there. Who cares?
You preach it, sister. Amen. Yes. I love that.
Oh, good.
Thanks, okay, ladies.
So what is this blueprint that you keep talking about? Tell our listeners what you're saying.
It is, I'm talking about an MO, a modus operandi of how, that's the pattern I'm talking about. So when you take the student aptitude quiz, or you guys took it, you had your kids take it. When you take that, you get a pattern, a four-digit number. That's what I'm talking about, your pattern for taking action.
And that's the Kolbe Index, K-O-L-B-E. Correct. And so listeners, you can check that out at home, K-O-L-B-E.com. But of course, the first place you want to start is with Gail's website. But in general, if you want to, what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is a bigger dream of mine. It's definitely not the Gail show. I mean, it is, you know the pattern. If you want help with what it means, that's where I come in. Yeah.
Okay. So what does that look like?
Knowing the pattern or knowing what it means? Both.
What does it look like to work with? Yeah, both. Like walk us through what listeners need to do to find out this information about their child. And then what do they do with the information?
Yeah. So you can take the test online or you can take it through me. I don't charge you any more or less. It's in the interpretation or the explaining of what this means for your child and why it's his path. So why is this four-digit number my kid's path? Like, what does that mean? Well, that means that when you innately know how they work. So for example, your son, I'm just going to take one line of the Kolbe. There are four different lines. The red is the details and information. The blue, the second line, is the systems and organization. The green is risk and uncertainty. And the yellow is hands-on or called implementer. Those are the four. Yeah.
Say that again. Repeat it so that listeners really get it in their head. Say that again.
Okay. So the red, the first line of the report, deals with your need for information. So at the top, if you're at the top, you'll have a need for very little information to make your best decision. At the bottom, you will need a lot of information to make your best decision. The second line is the blue, and this deals with systems and organization. At the top, you need very little structure to make your best decision. And at the bottom of the blue, you need a lot of structure and systems to make your best decision. The green is risk and uncertainty. At the top of the green, you work to stabilize and minimize risk. You don't need surprises or things changing all the time. At the bottom of the green, you need a lot of change. You need a lot of freedom to do things your way. Does that mean? And then the yellow is your need to get your hands on the environment. So at the top of the yellow, you do not need to touch to believe it's there. You can envision in your mind, imagine how something physical will look. If you were at the bottom of the yellow, you need to get your hands on the environment. Circle time for these kids is very excruciating because they need to touch their neighbor and they're told not to. So now you have a bad child with an innate strength to touch the world, but you've just made a bad child out of that. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Yes. Ouch.
Okay. Well, right. No, and as a former pre-K teacher, I was a teacher before I was a psychologist. So yes, there's always that one or two children, right, who cannot keep their hands to themselves, where you're asking them to sit on their hands.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
That's excruciating.
Yes.
That's my son. That's my son. And I, Teri, I get it. I did wrong by him. I mean, until he was 9 or 10. So I get it. I get it. I cried when I heard this and found this out about him. And I made him a bad kid because he'd go into stores and he'd touch stuff. And that was one of my 5-store rules. You don't touch the stuff. And if I would have known this, I would have given him something to touch.
Right.
That would have made all the difference in the world. He's not a bad child.
He's right.
It's not a bad thing. So here's where it connects to the path, ladies. If you have a child, we're going to go with this theme, that needs to get their hands on the environment and needs to be outside, he needs to be moving. What kind of work do you think that child's going to do? Do you think they're going to be an accountant in an office with no windows? Oh. That's a no. Here's what they're going to do naturally. So if you take that and you can know that at 3 years old, if you know a child needs to get their hands on the environment, as a parent, get their hands on the environment.
Yeah.
Put them in situations to garden, to cook, to weld, to build, to create, to use your hands. That's how the MO creates your pattern, your path. It doesn't change. So my son welds. Is that a surprise? No.
That's awesome.
Do you see what I mean? It's not a far jump. Is he going to make money sporadically and be his own boss? Absolutely. Absolutely. He's going to make money on his creativity. And the more he gets his hands on the environment, ladies, the better the world is. In my opinion, it's a crime to like stifle that and make it something bad or something it shouldn't be. Thank you. I'm so ranting today. You guys are getting me fired up.
It's so good. I mean, I'm thinking I have kids that are all over the map with different, I can see the different bents in them.
Yeah.
Just imagining it. I've only had my one son. My son, Dakota, did the Kolbe Index, the student assessment. But yeah, I mean, my oldest is 27. My youngest is 9.
Wow.
And so
she has nine kids, by the way.
Yeah.
You have 9?
Yes.
Wow. That's awesome. Way to go. Really cool. That's awesome.
But so it's, I have regrets for the older ones. And yet I know that I am, someday they're going to all get together and the older ones, you know, they're going to all be at a family reunion. The older ones are going to be like, who was your mom? Like, that was not my mom. My mom was a different mom than your mom of the youngest, you know, that we're learning and growing all the time. And so even what you're talking about, I want to encourage listeners, as I'm feeling encouraged, that even if, like you said, you did wrong by your kid up to a certain age, that it's never too late.
Really good
point. To dig into these things that can help us as a parent. If I had been able to dig into this with my daughter Autumn when she was 15, well, maybe she wouldn't have had as rough of the last 2 years of high school. You know what I mean? And even now, she's an adult. I can learn how to be a better mom and Grammy eventually to her as a mom, you know, that we can always learn and grow, always be getting better by our kids.
Yes.
You know, and one of the benefits I see to this too, and Gail, you and I talked about this prior, is there is this resurgence of apprenticeships right now. And there is a trend towards saying, look, there are alternatives to going to a 4-year university right after high school. And there are so many different paths that are available out there that we need to change our thinking that's the path for every child, right? They go to middle school, high school, and then automatically go to a 4-year university. Mm-hmm. Well, if that's not what drives our child, I mean, like you were saying, the child who needs to touch and feel the world, then maybe that type of classroom environment as an adult is not going to work for them, right? Especially if hands-on careers can be trained for through apprenticeships and other ways, right? I mean, and we need to be open to that as parents.
I've had people say, I can't believe you're like allowing your son not to go. And of course, remember, you got to remember the theme. If you have a big picture theme, it makes all the answers easier and the efforts on the ground. So if you want to raise a contributor, right? Yes. That's our goal. And you keep going back to that. Like, does this action match the goal? Does it match the goal? And if it doesn't match the goal, it's not worth your time. So is a four-year education going to make my son a better or worse contributor? That would be a no. I mean, it's not necessarily going to make him a better contributor. Since third grade, since he took the ding, and since then he's made decisions and dealt with the consequences. I actually, as a mom, I did a really scary thing and I took high school off the table. Because if the want or desire isn't there, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. It's borrowed desire from your parents. You're borrowing what someone else wants you to do. It's, in my opinion, it works when it comes from within. So he had to want to go to high school, and he actually has an MO that's the opposite of teachers. 70% of teachers work one way, 70%. And if you are a child who works differently than that way, Teri, as you're aware, Dr. Amy, you're aware, I'm aware, life will be difficult in school. So I have a son that is the opposite of the teachers. And so if he doesn't have desire to go to school on his own, along with an MO that's as difficult as it is, it's not going to work. When he took college off the table himself, but isn't it interesting? Now that he has the freedom, he's coming around to make decisions about 18-month degrees on his own. And he's looking into them on his own. I can get this degree. I can get this degree and make myself. So do you see how it's like adding on, the more freedom he has, the more he's willing to do. And I see that, and you foster it, and I just go with it.
Yeah.
Because you're following his particular blueprint.
Yeah.
Right. But we're not saying to listeners that that's every child's blueprint. There are children out there that are going to have a profile that says, yes, four-year degree in graduate school is going to be the best path for that child.
Yeah. Right? My other son is that way. Okay. He is going to college. He is cybersecurity. He actually is like your son, Teri. I mean, he initiates in that blue line. Mm-hmm. So he is going to school and he's figuring out how to get scholarships and do it right now. So yes, Dr. Amy, you're right. He is going to go to a four-year school and he may go on for continuing education after that. You're absolutely right.
I'm so curious. I'm definitely going to do this. I'm going to be following up with you. I'm definitely going to do this. Thinking about over the Thanksgiving holidays with all of my family, when all the kids get together, like I just imagine us sitting around the living room and everyone has their, an iPad, a computer, or what, and we're going to be like, okay, we are getting on. Do not talk about this amongst yourselves, people. Do not try to should on each other. Don't should on what the answer should be, but just be free, be yourself.
Right.
And I'm really curious, my high school sons, one of them is a student at Colorado Early Colleges. Mm-hmm. And he, with Amy's son, as a sophomore in high school, he is basically a sophomore in college because he's so advanced. He's such a go-getter. He likes to get knowledge, to plan, to analyze, dig in. His brother, just 15 months older than my just older son, who's a junior in high school, he is social. He is in he's in all the different clubs at school. He's in the Bible study club and the small group and the this and that, cross country and madrigals and all these things. And he's just about failing out of high school academically. Mm-hmm. But he is so happy. He's a socialite. They are going to have completely different paths.
Probably.
And I need to know that and embrace that as a mother, instead of being like, oh, Canyon is my good son. He's smart and good. And Ian is he's my flighty son. He's failing out. He's not smart and good. Oh yeah, he is. It's just different.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly.
So how does knowing your child's blueprint, how does that change the family dynamic? And while you're speaking on that, talk a little bit about what happens if mom and dad don't agree on following this.
Oof.
Like, what if one's traditional and not as flexible?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And that, you know, that's normal and that's common.
Right.
So a lot of people don't like to see the balloon pop under their roof.
Mm-hmm. It's messy, right? Messy.
Yeah, no. Yeah, it is. It's messy. And conative, how they're wired is stronger than cognitive and affective. So it will always come out. It'll come out under their roof or it'll come out outside of their roof. One way or the other, it's going to rise to the surface. And I've seen, I mean, I've talked to, you know, 60-year-old millionaires who are divorced or stroke or health issues, and they wish they would have known this because they have physical repercussions from going against their grain for so long. It can cause health issues. But to your first question of how I use this in the family, is that like,
yeah, how does knowing this information change the family dynamic?
Right. Right. Okay. So my husband is not like me at all. He is very into the details. And so in college, when I met him, I decided it would be fun to rapid fire a lot of questions at him. And I would ask him all sorts of questions as fast as possible. Like, we were running out of time because I need a sense of urgency to get things done. Remember, he does not. So before I knew and was trained about this, I used to equate a negative connotation to slow thinkers. I used to place a judgment on people that needed time. And that was arrogance and immaturity on my part, but I did it. I would do it to people all the time and think that it was less than. So he kept saying things to me like, it depends. And I would say, on what? Make a decision. I don't understand. Why does it depend? Until I know his Kolbe. And until I realized that he needed time to decide and make the most appropriate, precise, thorough decision. 24 years later, I've used this gift since we've been married since 1997. He's the detail guy. He's the research guy. He's the guy that when I say the dishwasher broke, let's get a top of the line and be done with it. He said, let's see what Consumer Reports says. And I'll say, I'm bored. It's up to you. Tell me when you're done. So we use his gift for the details because he's the detail guy. My oldest son, Noah, has the strength like Terry's son, the long blue line with systems and organization. This is how we use the strength. When the gas grill came to the house, he was 11. I knew how he worked. He was the only one in the house that will finish what he starts. Everyone else doesn't need to finish what they start. And he said, can I put the gas grill together? My husband's like, come on. What's the worst thing that can happen? Let's let him do it. It's like a big Lego. He's like, it's $1,000 gas grill, Gail. It's not a big Lego. And I said, but he'll finish it. I know it because I know how he works and I'm trusting it. And from 1 to 5, hot mitts, it was 100 and who cares? He put the whole thing together.
Wow.
Did he make a mistake? Did he make a mistake? Absolutely. But what did he do? He's like, I went back a page, just like a Lego. If it didn't fit, he went back a page. If it were not for his Kolbe, I would have never, ever let an 11-year-old put together a gas grill. My second son is a pioneer. We're at the top of a mountain. We're kind of lost. He's 9. I said, Tyler, got to get us off this mountain, buddy. His parents and his older brother were all lost. And he's 9 years old and he gets us off the mountain because he has the only conative gift with the need for space and tangibles out of the whole family. So if we're ever in a situation physically, he'll know how to get us out of it. That's how I've used their strengths in the family.
I just have chills. That's just so beautiful.
Love it. Well, and this is, you know, so my child, who's also a pioneer, he's a competitive rock climber and has been climbing things since he was 2 years old. His nickname's been Monkey since he was old enough to, I mean, on everything. We had to I came home one day and my husband had tied the dining room chairs to the center of the table because Evan was using the chairs as a ladder when he was 2 years old to propel himself up onto high things, right? We came home one day and he had unscrewed the handrail from the wall going down the stairs and removed every cabinet door from the entertainment center in the basement with a screwdriver when he was two because he had to touch everything.
Pattern predicts your path, right? I mean, you get it. You see where this is going. He's in it. That's awesome, Dr. Amy.
Right. Well, and he's also an elite musician because he can use his fingers. He is the piccolo player in the city's youth symphony. So, oh my gosh. Yeah.
Oh, that's so cool.
Hates
you went
school.
With it. You went
hates
with it.
School.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. School's not made for him.
No.
Yeah.
So I love it. Okay. So
you just said something. Hold up. I hope everyone heard that. You just said something so profound. School's not made for him. You didn't say he's not made for school. You didn't say he's no good in school. You said school's not made for him.
It's not.
That is a really beautiful big distinction that separates what you were talking about, that our kids' bents, their different cognitive abilities, do not make them good or bad for school. It may mean that school is not good for them.
Right.
Love it.
Yes.
So back to the second half of my question, what happens when both parents don't agree on using the blueprint in decision-making for raising their kids?
Mm-hmm.
What is your advice to them?
So my parents, and I was older when I had it done, but when they saw it, they were kind of like, "Aunt, you still need to do things." And so it wasn't until I left the house that I was able to use my gifts. Okay. And I've been leaning into them ever since. That's fine. You don't have to pay attention to it. You don't have to pay attention to it at all. If you believe what you believe and you believe that it's the right way to do things, and your relationship is succeeding, then obviously keep doing what you're doing. I don't make anyone obviously do anything they're not meant to do. People don't call me to not pay attention to the results.
Right.
They may be surprised by them. They may be scared to release the grip. They might find some self-realizations about their way of parenting that they're not ready to come to terms with. But that child is perfectly capable of solving problems. I've recognized that when they're in houses where the parents are doing a lot for them, it's comfortable. And then I come in, they don't want to change. They don't want to be held responsible for their decisions. Because if they're 16 and they haven't been so far, why would they start until they had to? Does that make sense?
Sure.
Yeah. So some parents, even though that child has an MO that says college, a four-year college will be very, very difficult. They've said, well, I may adjust where they go to school, but they're still going to school. Mm-hmm. And that is a win in my opinion, because that's a slow turn to even acknowledge that this person might be different than you are. And I take that as a win.
Yeah. So we need to take a quick break and let Teri read a word from our sponsor. And when we come back, I'd love it if you would share a couple success stories with us.
Sure.
Okay.
Is your child struggling in more than one subject in school? Have you tried tutoring, but still aren't seeing the improvements you were hoping for? Most learning challenges aren't caused by a lack of instruction. They're typically caused by cognitive skills that need to be strengthened. Skills like auditory processing, memory, reasoning, attention, and processing speed. LearningRx one-on-one brain training programs are designed to target and strengthen the skills that we rely on for thinking and learning in every subject. LearningRx can help you identify which skills may be keeping your child from performing their best. In fact, they've worked with more than 100,000 children and adults who wanted to think and perform better. They'd like to help get your child on the path to a brighter and more confident future. Give LearningRx a call at 866-BRAIN-01 or visit learningrx.com. That's learningrx.com.
And we're back talking to Gail Swift about using the Kolbe assessment in our parenting decision-making and just being able to recognize our child's motivations and volition and natural instincts. And so, Gail, we would love it if you would just share with our listeners some success stories of using this assessment in raising kids.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. This is kind of, I'll give you a success story cognitively, but I'm also going to share a little bit of my personal journey that helped this family, because if I can be of help in any way I can, not just cognitively. So there's, when I gave a talk about my Tourette's and my overdose, dealing with that, or my abuse of the medication, a parent came up to me and said that they think they have a child similar to me with a cognitive disorder, and they're going to take him in to get medicine. And they wanted to talk with me about my journey with that and the cognitive and see if there's any connection. And so I had a conversation with them, and I said that when I abused the medication, I went back into my neurologist, and he told me something that's changed my life forever. I was 17 years old. I was going to college. It was very stressful. My tics were coming back. And so I went in to get the medication again. And he said, Gail, you've lost your privilege to take it, but here's how you can handle your tics naturally. Stay away from refined sugar, eat yellow and green vegetables, vitamin B6 to calm down your nervous system, get exercise, it's a natural dopamine release, and get plenty of sleep. And my first thought was, why didn't you tell me that 10 years ago? But instead, I used that information to help this third grade child and the parents sitting in front of me. I told these parents, what my doctor said to me way back when. I told him that I had a son that also has Tourette's. And when I encouraged my son to pay attention to the way he was feeling after certain foods, recognize if he was anxious after eating things, and pay attention to large crowds or what stressed him out, then he could be ahead of the stress instead of behind it. I also tested him cognitively, and he was in transition. When you're in transition, that means the algorithm won't complete itself. The Kolbe will not complete itself because that child is not free to be themselves, which means they're listening to voices that are louder than their own. And they're putting what they think their parents want or their doctors or their teachers ahead of what they want. And the test will not be complete. So this test wasn't complete. I reviewed that with the parents, and I said, in this particular area, he's thinking or believing that he needs to act this way, and that's not his natural grain. And the dad's like, oh, I know what's happening. And it had to do with reading at night. The way that dad was approaching reading time after this information changed completely. It was more of a free time. It was more of a snuggly time instead of a directive. And after 3 months, we retested him, and he had a solid Kolbe result. What happened was that child never went on medication. I met with the homeroom teacher. I met with his football coach. I met with the parents. He's in his lane, and he's thriving, and there is absolutely nothing wrong with him.
I got chills.
Oh, yes. So great.
That was huge. There's another girl that I worked with. She was 15. She was on anxiety medication and had a cognitive score where I understood where the anxiety was coming from. And after meeting with her about 8 times, she went off the medication, and she's ahead of it. She knows what to expect from herself. She knows where this is coming from, and she's free. She's free to be herself. She's taking things small and in increments, but it made complete sense to her. And now she can respectfully request what she needs and not feel bad about it. If she needs order, and if she needs systems, if she needs a theme for a birthday party, and someone poo-poos it or says, that's not necessary, she can say, it sounds like that's not necessary for you, but for me to be my best self, this is what I need. So may I please proceed with my best self.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Those are a couple.
So it's interesting to me, the application this could have in the counseling environment as well. And so like as a counselor, and I treat predominantly teenagers, and what an amazing tool that I feel motivated to go get certified to use.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're seeing, oh my goodness, we're seeing so much depression and anxiety among teenagers right now.
Yeah.
And if we could use these insights, wow, we could.
And there, you know, there is, I mean, there flat out is. And I made a video that I wasn't expecting to hit home as much as it did, but it was like, your life over grades, like happiness over grades is, anyway, I'm not going to get into it, but along the same lines, it is happening. Depression is happening and it's hard. It's flat out hard. And what I recognize is that when my kids are in that mode, speaking for myself and my family, acknowledging, allowing, not trying to make different. And even when I see them falling in, or I see them not doing what they could, or sitting on the couch too long, in my opinion, right? There's several ways to combat that, but I've found myself saying, I've seen what you are like when you really want something to get done or you're really motivated. And I know when you're ready, you will do it. And this is how you're going to do it. And nothing is stopping you. So I know it's in you. And I appreciate your couch time right now. It looks like you need it. I'm here when you're ready to get up.
Oh, that's so good. Oh my goodness. Okay. I want to just a logistical question for listeners. We talked about Kolbe Index, K-O-L-B-E. But for listeners who are like, oh, I'm so inspired. I want to understand this. I want to have my kid take this assessment. Where do we go? How do we get started?
Yeah. They can take it online or they can go to me. The only benefit with going through me is I'll have it in my website. I'll have it on my software, not my website. I'll have it on my software. So I'm able to give parent guides, stress tests, test reports, different kinds of like things that they may not get. And I can explain it to them in real terms. So when you get the report, it may or may not be easy for you to understand. You can try it, but then I can explain how it would apply to chores, friends, school, social, family, all aspects of life. And then I give you questions, how to encourage and inspire when they're not feeling motivated. So Gail at plans2prospercoaching.com. That's my email. That's the best way to get a hold of me.
Okay.
And that's your website as well.
Plans2prospercoaching.com. Yes.
Okay.
So we'll put that in the show notes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's what I was asking. That's where parents could go to get a kid assessment. And then another logistical question, how young? Okay. So when I was going over this with my 11-year-old son, like Amy said with her son, Evan, that it was just lickety split. He just went through it. Lickety split. Anyway. Yeah. And Evan, my 11-year-old son, it was so long and slow because he would say, what does that mean? I don't understand that.
Right.
So talk to me about age range.
Talk to you about age?
Age range, how you
can. Okay. So from three to nine, there's a nonverbal assessment. So nonverbal, meaning obviously no language is involved from 3 years old to nine. That is a bag of toys. It's called Brainy Act. So I use that. And then we can identify striving behavior in kids from 3 years old to about nine. When they have a fourth grade reading level, strong fourth grade reading level, they're able to do the student aptitude quiz, or SAQ for short. And that is from age 9 or 10, depending on the reading level, until 22, 23. And that also, and then the last one is the Kolbe A index. A stands for adults. That is for 18 and up. So that's an adult index. Those are the age ranges. Mm-hmm.
So the Kolbe A index, I was gathering family together and my husband and I were going to do that, we would each do the Kolbe A index?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
And then is it the same four pillars that?
It is.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
It is. The only difference is in the 3 to 9 years old, they're not numbers. They're just segments or blocks, because when kids, they think that a high or a low, the only difference between a 1 and a 10 is time spent in that area. Time is the only differentiator. It has nothing to do with good or bad, but kids, I would say between 5 and 9 will see a higher number is better than a lower number.
Right.
So we leave the numbers off of that test for that reason.
That's smart. Insightful.
They're all strengths. Yes.
Excellent. So for those of you who are watching on YouTube, I'm going to share my screen really quickly just so that you can see what that, what those pillars look like. This is Evan's, my almost 17-year-old. I took it for him, by the way, and then had him take it, and we scored almost identically. But that's probably
just, that's just crazy.
Yes, that's probably not common. But as a psychologist, I'm constantly testing Evan on lots of things, so I know him pretty well. Anyway, Gail, is there anything that you haven't gotten to say that you still want to leave our listeners with?
No, there isn't. You guys have been so fun. I feel like this could last a long time.
Yeah,
I've just really enjoyed my time with you and your questions and your interest. And I'm so glad that your kids took it. And you know what, Teri, you're right. Your son needs a system and format to follow for sure. And Dr. Amy's doesn't. And so some kids will obviously sail through this in 10 minutes and others it will take 30. That's great. Either way, you'll get it done and it'll be fine. And if there's a transition result, that just means you need a little time. You need to back up a little freedom to be you. And I can work through that with you. And then you can take it again whenever the transition's out.
What does that look like? A transition result? Tell us
it'll have a little asterisk where the number is. So for example, if you have an asterisk in either the red, that means that you're not free to, you either need more or less information and you're taking someone else's thoughts or words more important than your own. So you're like, well, my dad said I needed to have 5 sources cited and I only really want 1, but I'm going to put down what I think should be the answer.
Right.
And it'll flag it. It's not congruent with the rest of the questions.
Okay.
And so it will be incomplete. Okay. And then when that happens, I will pull the student or person aside and say, tell me about this. What, tell me about this experience. Are you, you know, where is this coming from? And then we'll kind of get to it. And then I will let anyone else know if the parent needs to know. And then in a matter of weeks or months, depending on what's going on in their life, then we'll back up and then take it again a couple weeks or months later.
So interesting. Okay.
Absolutely.
But thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. It's great.
Yep. Yes. So we are out of time and need to wrap up, but we want to thank our guest today, Gail Swift, for sharing this really valuable information with our listeners. I'm so excited that we were able to bring them this information. As moms ourselves, we know how valuable it is, and wanted to bring awareness to this aspect of our minds that is so often neglected and has so much influence on behavior.
Yes.
For sure. So if you want to connect with Gail, again, her website is plans to prosper coaching.com. You can email her at gail@plans2prospercoaching.com and we will put that mouthful in the show notes. So thank you so much for listening today. If you liked our show, we would love it if you would leave us a 5-star rating and review on Apple Podcasts. We are on YouTube if you'd like to watch us instead of listen. You can follow us on social media or on every channel at The Brainy Moms. So look, until next time, we know that you're busy moms and we're busy moms. So we're out.
See ya.